some message at least. So, talking about the IBP, as we all know, you know, it's a device which cardiologists like very much to put into the patients with cardiogenic shock. And our standard teaching was anyone who has acute myocardial infarction with hypotension and going towards cardiogenic shock, you insert this as a bridge between either the patient is going for a CABG or angioplasty for maintaining hemodynamics for 48 to 72 hours. Let's look into the insights of this. So, straight away talking of a paper from American Journal of Cardiology 2016, where they had compared the use of mechanical circulatory support in percutaneous coronary interventions. And they found that the use of IABP exceeded the use of PVAD, that is percutaneous ventricular assist devices, by more than 20-fold. And the reason was very obvious, that it is easy to put, easily available. But what they found was in-hospital mortality was lower with PVAD. What does that mean that we will see? And in the era of demonetization and GST, I would assure you to stick to the current evidence and the recent advances and not the cancelled notes. So, talking about the principles of IABP in general, and I would like to, because I'm slightly this thing about the crowd, where I suppose is a mix of students and the practicing intensivists here. So, these are a few basic concepts for IABP, and it's basically a cardiac assist device which augments in the diastole the phase of blood pressure by balloon counterpulsation technique. It displaces the blood volume and pressure changes, which is caused by the rapid shuttling of the helium in and out of the balloon. So the inflation and the deflation of this balloon causes the blood to displace in the aorta. So it looks something like this, and during the diastole, as you could see, it is getting inflated, and during systole, it gets deflated. So what happens is actually, as this is the normal coronary blood flow in the left coronary, and you could see that in diastole it fills up. So we want a good coronary blood flow during the diastole, whereas in right coronary, as you could see, this is the right coronary blood flow. And so this is the precise thing what the IABP does, is augments the diastolic pressure. It increases the coronary perfusion because it gets inflated during the diastole. And of course, it increases the myocardial oxygen. Whereas it deflates in the systole, whereas because of this, it actually decreases the afterload and it decreases the cardiac workload. Of course, it will decrease the myocardial oxygen consumption and in turn will increase the cardiac output. So these are the basic mechanism as to how IABP actually works. And of course, there's a balance of the supply and the demand which it tries to look for. And these are on your left hand side, the standard indications for IABP, and you can read for yourselves. Importantly being, we are discussing the cardiogenic shocks here. So cardiogenic shock secondary to STEMI would be the was once upon a time a class 1 recommendation indication for IABP. And these are the contraindications. I feel you should know and you should be aware of the contraindications more importantly, like severe aortic regurgitation, aortic dissection, peripheral vascular disease, and irreversible brain damage. And the balloon looks something like this. As regards the size, these are the different sizes for the balloons, and starting from the 50cc to 25cc, which depends upon the height of the person. And this is what it does. It's a flexible catheter which is inserted from the femoral artery and it's passed in the descending aorta. The correct position, which is very critical because we don't want the blockage of the subclavian carotid and the renal arteries down. It is usually placed 1 to 2 centimeter below the origin of subclavian. So the standard teaching for a patient on IBP is to palpate the left radial artery. And it inflates about 85 to 90% of the aorta gets blocked. And because, as we know, the complete occlusion will obviously traumatize the mucosa, the intima. So this is what the X-ray position looks like, and it's ideally between the second and the third intercostal space. And again, talking about the X-ray, of course, we do the X-ray after IVP incision, as I was talking to you in the morning. So continuing the literature further, and this was one of the research article of effectiveness of IABPs in MI for patients with or without cardiogenic shock. And so this included the RCTs which demonstrated the IABP, and they have said that it may reduce the 30-day and 6 months mortality. But important thing is the patients which were included were MI without cardiogenic shock. So further they say that there is no clinical benefit which was demonstrated in patients with high risk PCI without cardiogenic shock and AMI complicated with cardiogenic shock, and future trials are required. So this was the article and the paper which looked at the AMI without cardiogenic shock, where they found that there could be some benefit for the same. This is what the trigger and the timing, and as you could see that this is the start of the R wave. This is the timing of the trigger, and we will just discuss it in short. I think it got stuck. Right now we had one troubleshooting about the IVP, and so this is what the classic, again this is for the students, and this is the classical wave pattern which looks like on the console of IVP. As you could see that this is unassisted end diastole followed by the unassisted systole and the D, which is the augmented diastole. Followed by this wave, this is E, which is assisted end diastole, and this is assisted systole. So this is how a very classical wave of IABP looks like. And it means that when you have this kind of wave, and this area under curve actually denotes the coronary perfusion which is increased, whereas this dip actually goes with reduced myocardial oxygen demand. As I'm sure that you would be aware of the frequencies of IABPs which you keep, right, from 1:1, 1:2 and so on. So this is how a typical 1:2 IABP wave looks like. I'll talk about a little about a basic knowledge of the inflation and the deflation, which will be definitely useful to you. So if we have early inflation, and if you have a troubleshooting in that, the bradycardia, it will obviously be prolonged. In tachycardia, it will be shortened. And if you have a gas leak and the helium is used, you could see that it is going, the balloon trace goes below the baseline. Whereas if it is kinked, then you will see something like this. So again, these are, you know, important kind of slides which you should remember. Now, this was another by Dr. Pinsky and group in the Critical Care 2013. Whether does IABP for MI with cardiogenic shock really improves the outcome? And there they have said that there was no significant difference in the secondary endpoints or in the process of care measures, including the time to hemodynamic stabilization, length of stay in ICU, serum lactate levels, and the dose and the duration of catecholamine usage. So the conclusions which they drew were the IABP did not actually significantly reduce the 30-day mortality, and the commentary which was done in the same paper showed that because it's a dreaded complication of AMI with a very high mortality of approaching about 70 to 80%, and the lack of randomization or the clinical trials, the recommendation for adjuvant therapy has been based only on pathophysiological assumptions and expert opinion. So again, we are coming to the same point where we need to actually individualize the patient, not as a blanket policy or as a guideline, as far as this evidences are concerned. So the recommendation is as far as this particular paper is concerned, routinely use of IBP need not be the default therapeutic approach, as I already told you. Now, this was another review article of IBP in patients with cardiogenic shock, complicating MI, and this was the background where they said that the recent randomized trial suggests that the use of IBP does not reduce the mortality. Thus, they should have. And this was another very, very extensive database with the Cochrane library, where IBP for MI complicated by cardiogenic shock, and what they found was the statement which they did was it is most noteworthy that a recently conducted and a published large randomized control trial showed no evidence for survival with the use of IBP. And the European Society of Cardiology also has said that is it's no longer recommended. And I'm sure listening to all these talks, initially we had these questions as to what is the GST and what does it really mean. I'm sure these things are going in your minds, but we'll make it a little more easier. So this was another paper with the influence of cardiogenic shock with or without use of IBP and their effect on the mortality of these patients. So this is a huge patient database, I think 4,200 patients here on this side and 4,000 odd patients on the other side. What they found was they had the short and the long term mortality that may be improved with IBP implantation, but more studies are required. So by and large, as we could see that we have actually seen with cardiogenic shock complicated by myocardial infarction, and they said that there is no effect of IBP treatment on microvascular perfusion, where they looked at the microvascular perfusion along with few biomarkers like angiopoietin or something like that, or catalytic iron levels, where they found that it actually does not affect the microvascular perfusion. So you know, summarizing and trying to kind of give you a clear-cut messages, I would say that the present-day evidence does not show any survival benefit with IBPs. Don't get stuck up to your cardiologist's dominance to put IBPs and all sorts of big things into the patient. It may be of use in AMI without cardiogenic shock. Those who don't have this obvious overt cardiogenic shock, but they are waiting for CABGs, and so for them you can actually individualize the decision based on the clinical grounds. And I always feel in English, I think there are, in medicine there are these words which are very handy for the doctors: it may help, it may not help, and the possibility of this cannot be ruled out, and please correlate clinically. These are things which help us always, and I hope I am able to give you a good message today. Thank you so much.